You're listening to the Unsung Podcast, where we talk about classic albums and decide if they deserve that distinction. And we also talk about some unsung classics in the hopes of bringing them to a new audience. And at the end of it all, we let you decide if we are right or wrong. This is the Unsung Podcast. Welcome to episode 11 of the Unsung Podcast. Now, as you can probably tell by the title, this week we're talking about Third by Portishead. But of course, before we get there, we need to discuss what happened last week. And the votes are in. Public did indeed decide that we were right, and that The Downward Spiral by Nine Inch Nails makes it into a discography of all-time classic albums, which is, I think, a good decision, because hey, it's fucking phenomenal. Before we get into this week's episode, I should probably just warn you that the recording is a little different this week. You see, we've been cobbling together gear for a little while now, and the gear we cobbled together for this particular episode is, well, good. Didn't give us the same sound as before. If it sounds a bit different with some audio issues, then that's why. But the conversation itself is, I think, totally worth listening to, and hopefully you will enjoy it. This is Chris, Weaver and I, talking about Third by Portishead.
Esteja alerta para as regras dos três. O que você dá retornará para você. Essa lição você tem que aprender. Você só ganha o que você merece.
I am your host, Mark Fraser, and today I'm joined by two fabulous gentlemen.
On my right is Mr. Chris Cusack, Glasgow's foremost conceptual artist. He often uses whole wheat pasta to create sculptures to really bring out, I don't know, pasta. I've given up. Hi, Chris.
Some flow. Yeah, to my left is David Weaver, who today is wearing what can only be referred to as sneakers.
Sneakers.
Sneakers. Not trainers.
Sneakers.
Sneakers. Sneakers. Yeah, I think my uncle had these in 1978. But the rubber outsole
he
perished.
Dug them up and took them back.
Yep. That's me.
Are they the same ones?
I know, but he did have pretty much the same model. And I tried to wear them, but the rubber had literally perished.
Wow.
And fell apart on my socks.
Dave, so I just went out and bought new versions.
King of retro.
That's me.
On this episode, we're talking about Third by Portishead.
Oh, you've been telling me about mic discipline, and I just did the exact wrong thing there, but it was still to get the sound of the bat of the
you've
the
got
song.
A pop shield though, so it's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like that Razzle thing. just doing those weird, like, what's it called again? Scatting.
Beatbox.
Beatboxing, yeah, that's the one. God, I told you it was the whitest guy in the room.
Why are we doing this record?
Was this my choice?
I think this was your choice, Chris.
Now. So many aborted attempts.
Yeah, this was your choice, Chris.
Portishead are amazing. I don't think there's any getting away from that. Like, Portishead are one of the most interesting bands to come out of the UK in the last couple of decades. And I think alongside Radiohead are one of those bands that have got, like, maybe even more so, that nothing they've done has ever been less than really good.
They've done a lot less than Radiohead, though.
They've done a lot less
they've
than
only
Radiohead
done three records,
in terms
but...
of quantity. Absolutely, aye. They've also been a lot less patronising than Radiohead.
Yeah, aye.
Third is an unusual choice for Portishead, but Dummy, I think, would be the most famous one. And go for things like Glory Box as being their most obvious touchstones for the band themselves. Third, I think, is one of the hardest albums to work out where it came from, and I love that in an album. When you get an album and you're like trying to mentally join the dots of how the artists got to where they got to, it's an album with a little bit of like study. You can work out the genesis of the different influences and the trajectory of the different careers and how they got there. But in and of itself, it's totally inexplicable because it's really quite glum, but it's unbelievably cool at the same time. It's sort of half-assed, but deliberately half-assed. Like, the tones are unfussy. Even some of the takes are deliberately unfussy. There's, you know, some clipped notes here and there, and they've left all these little details in. There's something beautifully relaxed and confident about it as an album. It's the kind of thing I think you can only really do after you've been in a band for like 17 years or whatever they had been at this point, and exude a sort of confidence. And I mean, it's kind of consistent with their personas anyway. Like Jeff Barrow's Twitter is a perfect example of, like, he's sort of like pretty nonplussed by most things in a kind of really quite entertaining way. And I think this is a good example of that. This is a band that were just like, this is what we want to do. I think there's a quote kicking about, which is something like, they wanted to sound like themselves as opposed to just recreating what they'd recreated before. This album was far less sampled than, say, the first album.
As in, it uses less samples?
Yeah. Sorry, aye. Like, in Dummy, there's a lot of, like, really prominent, quite famous kind of artists and stuff. So it's Sir Times, Lalo Schifrin, I think the guy's name is. There's a song called The Danube Incident. And it seems, in and of itself, it's quite silly. Then you hear it and you just start singing Sour Times over it. It's unbelievable how they heard that and were like, we can make that into a really creepy song. I think there's stuff by The Weather Report. There might even be some by Isaac Hayes. There's loads of like little Easter eggs in it in that sense. The second album, the eponymous second album, which is a tremendous album again, and maybe again slightly sadder than Dummy, which seemed like an achievement, is far less sampled. I think there's just a couple of bits in that. Although I think in the sleeve notes it does say that there's multiple samples, and in fact they're kind of bumming their load. They've just made up silly names and stuff. But by the third one, they were really just like, let's create everything from scratch. And it just betrays a band that has gone beyond the kind of constraints that I think most bands would never get to a stage where they were able to do something as completely esoteric as this album.
Especially on a third record.
Yeah, and especially the gap between this and the second record. You know, you think that a band might go away and get lost, or maybe come out with something, you know, overproduced, you know, but you're right in that it does have those, you know, those takes that aren't perfect but are organic and fit really well, which is interesting. Yeah, I think going back to the first two records, they are of an era. Like, they sound very much of their time, maybe, and this sounds a lot more timeless.
Do you know that Dummy was nominated for the 1995 Mercury Music Prize? Alongside Definitely Maybe. Like, that's mental.
I mean, that's a timeless classic.
That is mental. It was like, and like, PJ Harvey's To Bring You My Love as well. British scene at the time was really pretty interesting. I mean, whatever you think about Oasis now, they were a relevant band back then. And PJ Harvey was great and Tricky. Like, Max and Quay was in that nomination list as well. And obviously Tricky's part of that kind of Bristol scene, the inverted commas Bristol scene, which is like just in itself, you know. Banksy came for that, and there was a whole bunch of newsletters and kind of counterculture papers. Left-wing politics was a big thing in that scene, and Dummy was really sits well in that era. Remember the magazines like Vox and stuff were about at that time as well, weren't they? It was like, it was quite a different kind of landscape musically.
I don't know, Chris, I was reading Shoot magazine because I was only 8.
You were in that what was the cartoon in Kerrang, the goth
Pandora.
Pandora, yeah.
I was too young for Pandora. I was still at the Beano, mate. Minnie the Minx.
Sorry, yeah. But yeah, you're right. The first album is very of its time.
And then the second album got a bit gothier. Darker.
Like, should we say of its time, but people did kind of reckon it was like the pinnacle of trip-hop. Like, it was innovative.
Yeah.
We're not phrasing that well. It didn't sound like anything particular that was there. It was part of a scene that was emerging.
Listen back to it now and you go, oh yeah, that's like mid-90s trip-hop, fits in with Massive Attack, fits in with, you know, stuff like that.
I suppose.
And then, yeah, the second album just went a bit gloomier, went a bit darker.
I love the second album. Like, it's really, really good.
But I'm with you. I think this is the defining record because it doesn't sound like anything else, really. It sounds like Portishead doing whatever the fuck they want.
The thing is, I think there's an argument that could be made that Dummy or even Portishead by Portishead, you know, and stuff like All Mine and Over off that second album, they possibly sound like most people's interpretation of Portishead, but not, it doesn't, it seems to me, not the band Portishead's interpretation of the band Portishead, which is kind of why this album's so interesting. But I think a lot of people do just associate them with like little bits of scratching and little bits of like sampled stuff. And obviously Beth has a super distinctive, really, she plays with her vocals a lot. She does that kind of, how can I, sort of Shirley Bassey kind of nasal cavalry thing a lot.
Can you do that again?
How can I? but she doesn't really do that in the third album. Her voice is really fragile in the third album and really, really beautiful. She kind of goes away from that kind of cabaret sort of tongue-in-cheek thing a little bit. But I would, there's probably a lot of people that are going to say of this that the Portishead sound is probably more easily associated with her first two albums. But I do think this is better. And it's gloomier again. Just when you thought they can't get any gloomier, they got gloomier.
It's certainly the record that I go back and listen to in the Portishead back catalogue.
Back catalogue.
Yeah, in the back catalogue. And I think, yeah, I mentioned this before, but we talked about a record before DJ Shadow introduced it, and that was another, although it came from out with the Bristol scene, it was another sort of defining record in the trip-hop genre. And much like Dummy, it was used a lot of samples, sort of defined a very specific sound. And then both of their second records just sounded a bit different, maybe aren't seen as quite the classics as the first ones, but still great records. And then the third records from each, I think what DJ Shadow did, he went away and created The Outsider, and to me that album is pretty shit. You know, it's the sound of somebody not knowing quite, you know, what world he wants to direct it at. Talented DJ, amazing producer, but you know, what is that album? It has no sort of identity. Whereas what Portishead went and did, you know, was just, you know, become a really fucking tight band, even just the three of them.
It's interesting because Portishead, maybe worth a bit of trivia, but Portishead started as Jeff Barrow and Beth Gibbons as a duo, and then Adrian Utley recorded them or worked on the first record with them and then joined because the collaboration was so productive. But you were saying about the hiatus, it's interesting based on what you're saying, like what went on in that gap before this third album, like how did this third album come out so differently? And there's like, when you read some of the interviews with especially Jeff Barrow and Adrian Utley, they were really struggling creatively, and they supposedly had considered just wrapping up the project. They didn't want to water it down, they didn't want to just retread old material. And of all people, I think they were working, recording that band, The Coral, supposedly, anyway. Like, they were so impressed by the sort of
enthusiasm.
I think more specifically the lack of concern the guys in that band showed for what people expected of them. They were just really taken with the fact that these guys went in and just tried stuff and did stuff on the record. I've no idea what that record turned out like, by the way. I don't know the one in question. But supposedly they found that really inspiring, and they then embarked upon this third set of material, you know, from like, I think it was the end of 2006 they did that, something like that, and this came out in 2008. And it was a big departure. Barrow had, I don't know my chronology exactly here, but obviously he's got a project called Beak. I don't know exactly when Beak started, but Beak is very much closer to this than it is to any of the earlier Portishead stuff. It's like old kind of vintage synths. It's very, very krauty, very droney, really weird. I mean, the list of technology that they used in this, the stuff like Mini Moogs, it's an MS-20, an ARP 2600, I think is the one. Stuff like that is like, is much more akin to Beak, and the kind of like the lo-fi weird uneasy oscillators that are just a fraction out, kind of dissonant thing they get without going too heavy-handed. So that's really seems to have informed, well, either this informed that project or the early stages of that project informed this recording.
Yeah.
And this, I think it really benefits from it. But, oh, wow, once you start digging into the tracks, like once you start getting into the actual, the trained ear that it took to pick, because there's things in here that obviously aren't multi-layered. They've just picked a brilliant take and a brilliant tone, and they've just, there's just a level of like sophistication and self-confidence that comes through in this album. It's quite naked, like,
yeah,
and it's just like, it's,
well, I think like a track like Small, you know, that starts off, you know, just that wee synth sounds like somebody just, you know, noodling away,
and then
it just builds up and builds up, and
it's two and a half minute mark that one comes
in, and it sounds like a big kraut band, or, you know, it sounds like the Phantom Band, what the Phantom Band want to be, basically. You know, building up to that massive, you know, sound,
guitar cacophony thing, yeah, and some of the reviews of it, when you read the reviews, it's like, it's one of those weird things where you kind of, I don't know, you sort of feel like you're from a different planet sometimes. But some of the reviews, and a number of them, had a kind of similar theme, which was, it's perhaps more appropriate to admire this record than to enjoy it. As though they were like, oh, isn't it clever? Isn't it an achievement? But it's not fun to listen to.
Yeah, you're not going to listen to it.
Well, like, what's fun, man? Like, I mean, how asinine a comment is that? It's like, there's loads of great things, loads of great films that aren't fun to watch. Like, I just couldn't.
I hate fun.
I mean,
I don't like
that's
fun
what
things.
Brought us together in the first place. In fact, we were always the guys sitting at the edge of the dance floor. You know, it was like
arms crossed,
tears rolling down our cheeks. But I just it was the fact that was repeated across a number of reviews as well. People saying, "Oh, it's very clever, it's really impressive," but it's, I wouldn't listen to it. It's like, shut up. You know, I mean, this. I think, as Dave says, this is by far Bourne's most repeated listens for me than any other Portishead record, even going back. I mean, I was listening to them when they were coming out, and it was like, I still think this is better.
I found it quite hard. I found it really hard to get into this record, I've got to be honest. For me, it was just not clicking, but I stuck with it because something kept bringing me back. There's sounds and there's textures on this record that kept bringing me back, and I hadn't really heard Portishead before. I honestly couldn't tell you a Portishead song that I'd heard or what a Portishead song sounds like.
You haven't heard Glory Box?
Maybe I have, but I wouldn't be able to say.
Do you know that guy Chris Cunningham, the video director, did all the Bjork stuff and was like very, very well, kind of very celebrated.
I do not know him.
Late 90s. All right, because Portishead were one of the parts of the stable of people that he worked with in a song called Only You as well, and that was like a big kind of, you know. They were up there with like Bjork and stuff at the time, and I'm surprised that you managed to miss them.
I've only came into music which is kind of like this, later in life. I'm not even that old, but you know what I mean. Like,
you've got a fine beard though. So
I've always been, thank you. I've always been like a guitar guy. Always, I think that's what makes me a lot more receptive and willing to explore this music more, because I can listen to a record by a guitar band. I hate that, like, saying the words guitar band is fucking ridiculous, right? Anyway, just as an idea. But, like, I can, if it doesn't grab me in the first couple of lessons, that's it. Even if there's ideas in it that I like. But I kind of feel as though I had to try hard with this record, but I wanted to as well. And I get that in a lot of non, using the inverted commas, guitar records. And for me, this just, it clicked. When it clicked, it was like, fuck, this is not just good, but it's great. There's an accomplishment to it. Yeah, as three people that are going, look, let's just do us.
See,
and not think about it too much.
Like I was saying about like Jeff Barrow's Twitter, but also just Portishead by this point in general had a really, I think a quite entertaining nonchalance to them. Like, they don't really give a shit if you get what they're doing. And I think, like, even with the artwork for this album, it's like, here's the fucking cover. Just that's the cover. That's it. Right, we're not going to try too hard to impress you. Just listen to the record. The record's amazing. If you don't get it, it's your loss. There's just a nonchalance to the band, I think, that is, even like, you've seen the Rosalind Bowl performance. They've got a live video of the Rosalind Bowl that they did, and it's like, there's an album version of it as well. And they're a nonchalant band. Like, mm-hmm. I love that about them. They obviously are quite political. I mean, the whole Bristol scene was quite political, but they don't really bang that drum overly. They did some stuff for Joe Cox Memorial Fund after the murder.
Yep.
They released that cover SOS by ABBA. It had already been released, I think, but they re-released it.
Yeah, because it was used in High Rise movie.
That's right, and it's a fantastic ending to that film as well. But generally speaking, they're pretty indifferent to your perceptions of them, it seems like. They're not, they don't come across as rude, but they just come across as like adults. And I think as a result, there are people that are really like, I just don't get this. What's the point of this? And I'm not trying to shit in you here, Martin, because you have tried. But I'm kind of curious about, like, did you get in it? I don't just mean for the purposes of the podcast. I mean in a more kind of invested way. Like, would you give this, like, your own private time?
Well,
and what kind of broke that seal for you?
I think it was. I know you've said before the podcast started that it was an advert for a brand of perfume.
Oh God, yeah, that's the only caveat for what's probably the greatest Portishead tune ever written, and they went put it in a fucking Gucci advert.
I would have been driving when I was listening to it, or I was on the train, one or the other. It was definitely night time. It's a running theme, it seems to be doing stuff at night. And then when that song reaches its crescendo, I was like, fuck, I have to listen to this again very soon.
You're talking about The Rip?
Yeah, The Rip, yeah. This reminds me of Mr. Beast by Mogwai.
Yeah.
And I don't know why.
I have no idea why.
it's just got that overall, like a very cinematic feel to it, maybe.
Yeah, it does. Cinematic's probably the best way to describe this record for me. It is. Yeah. It feels like it's enveloping you. You know?
I am not going to agree with that.
Well, I think The Rip as a track could easily just fit on in Rainbows. Like, it could just slot on as a song. And it might be the best track on it.
I agree that I think like it's no coincidence as well that earlier on, like I mentioned Radiohead as well. I think they have a lot in common with their, like you said, their kind of esotericism. They're like, this is what we want to try. This might or might not work. It's maybe even more so like in the vein of like the kind of kiddie Amnesiac Radiohead, where they're really like, we're just going to do some really quite out there stuff and see if you come with us on it. I don't see it as being cinematic. I think Portishead are much more they're much more analogous to like a weird indie film or like a Todd Solondz film or something like that.
Yeah, but that's still a film.
Yeah, but
like, say like We Carry On and like that big guitar riff comes in. Like that could be in a fucking, like a big...
Yeah, but it's a guitar riff. It's not a guitar riff like a Glasgow Megasnake. Or, you know, it's not like
I don't know.
It's not that kind of guitar riff. It's like... It's still more uneasy.
Still quite epic in its own way.
Okay. We're probably going to agree to disagree on this, because if we don't, this will take forever. Okay, folks, time to ask for some cash. We love DIY. You can tell we love DIY. But earlier on today, we had to try and find an elastic band to attach a pencil to a microphone as a pop shield, because some random guy sent us it as a tip, because we're just cobbling this stuff together like some kind of weird alternative rock MacGyvers. And we just can't do that forever, because we're getting into our 30s now, and it's kind of embarrassing when I have to go home and tell my parents what became of my life.
In your 30s?
Did you just say you were just in your 30s, Chris?
Let it out. Anyway, we have a website, www.unsungpod.net/donate, and you can spend whatever you can afford, and I'll have no more comments about my age. Thanks, guys.
But to get back to your point, I'm glad that I spent time on this record, and I have spent time with it since we did the podcast before.
You mean the previous version of this
podcast? which has existed at some point somewhere.
On a corrupted card somewhere.
Yeah, so we were listening to it before we started recording as well, and it was like, yeah, man, I'm really into this.
Fan out though, right? So see, From The Rip, so you got in From The Rip, but like... You know, it's that thing where you get your first, like, right, this is my access point, but then you start to, like, pick up on the other signals here and there. Like, what ones?
I think for me, for a lot of people as well, Machine Gun would have been my access point. Because I think I heard that when it came out.
That's amazing, isn't it?
And I was, I think I was in, I was back at home from uni, and I just, you know, heard it and I was like, holy shit, the tones on that. And that's like one of those, this album just has tones and sounds and synth sounds and things that you don't really hear anywhere else, or they pick little bits from other genres and feed them into this one track or this one riff, in fact.
See that song, as good as the beat is, and the beat is completely distinctive and, and recognisable readily, and even at the end when they start to screw with the different kind of filters and stuff, that tone that comes in, you know, this sort of oscillated that is just such a clever bit of writing. It's so clever. I mean, they could have come in with a pad, they could have come in with anything. It's just, it's so like serpentine.
It makes you feel uneasy.
Yeah, and just really, really masterful bit of writing.
It's mostly the end of the record for me, which I kept coming back to, like Magic Doors and
Magic Doors
as well.
I think it's, it's maybe, I think The Rip's still Portishead's best tune, full stop, but Magic Doors is really up there. It's
Threads, it does remind me of the film. It makes me feel like the world's about to end.
I wonder if it's named after that.
The end bit of it, those kind of like,
Every
for people that don't know,
I'm doing a lot of sound effects tonight, I'm gonna.
Threads was so for people that don't know, Threads was like a BBC, like a 1980s BBC drama film about the apocalypse.
World War III.
Yeah.
And it's fucking terrifying still.
It is. And I mean, these guys would have been of the generation that watched it originally.
That were traumatized by it. Yeah,
absolutely fucking deformed, frightened out their tits.
Deformed.
I have to be honest.
Radioactive baby at the end.
The rest of Threads, for me, is the weakest song on the album. I still like it. But I think, like, in an album of astonishing music, it's the only track that I'm like, I can give or take, although I love the way they finish it. I think Beth played guitar on that song. They did a thing in this album where they kind of swapped instruments to try and get imperfect takes. I think like Adrian Utley had been interviewed about it, and he's, but I'm saying Utley, I hope it's Utley, not Utley. But he'd been interviewed and he'd said that, I can't remember how he worded it exactly, something like technique doesn't matter to me anymore or something like that, because they were quite accomplished musicians, but there's almost like a point of perfection where it ceases to be entirely interesting and you can become just very sort of self-indulgent. And
mechanical.
So he said, but this, they tried to push against that, and so they swapped instruments. For example, I think Barrow went for drums to bass, and, you know, and Beth Gibbons did a bit of guitar and that, and it was to try and get those little imperfections into the songs. I think it's The Rip, we were talking about little captured imperfections, the plucked guitar in that, it's a loop, and one of the notes just doesn't catch.
Muted.
It just goes like that. Oh, it's so nice that they left that in. Like, it's little things like that.
It's frustrating when you first hear it as well, because you're like, wow. But then you're like, ah, it makes sense.
But you realise, because it'd be too sweet, it'd be too perfect if it was a perfect take.
I love music like that, that's just not clinical, surgical.
Absolutely.
That has, that life still left in it.
Another band didn't need to do that on this record, or on any record. Because, you know, like you said, like we've said, they're accomplished and they've made so many records and been for so long. I think it's a really interesting thing. And I think that actually...
You're talking about Portishead?
Yeah.
They've only made 4 records, though, if you include the live album.
Yeah, but that, I mean, they've been together for a long time.
They've been together for a hell of a long time. But
so they've played together a lot.
But Dave does make the point, like, a lot of bands kind of gradually find their identity by releasing record after record and changing much more gradually. Like, this was a much bigger jump, albeit, what, a good, how many years? 11 years?
Yeah,
97 that the second Portishead album came out.
But you look at that, you say that, that's the same time as between OK Computer and In Rainbows, and Radiohead went through Kid A, Amnesiac, Hail to Thief, and, you know, got to that stage. They just did it and released all those records on the way. So it's interesting that Portishead just did the same change, but without the pathway.
It's like any fan thing. You'd be really curious to hear what it was they were writing in that period in between that they decided didn't actually want to release. You know, you'd be like, you know, whether they felt it was too close to their earlier stuff or what. Yeah, it must have been quite an interesting spell. I mean, it's there's so many good songs in this, but they're all really quite understated. It's a ballsy start to an album as well, like the silence, mm-hmm. that drum loop. I think the vocal sample at the start is someone, I think they got somebody to talk in Portuguese or something like that. Just off the top of my head, if I remember, from the last time we did this same podcast. But that rolling drum loop is just brilliant. And the fact that it's weirdly EQ'd as well. You know, it's like slightly muffled, mm-hmm. slightly mm-hmm. almost like they've recorded it off a tape recording of a drum machine. And it's just another really, really kind of daring start. Hunter's a good one as well. That's really dark.
A lot of this record's really dark. It's very, very gloomy.
Like, it's, yeah, I'm definitely not messing about. The one that isn't is that one, Deep Water, the wee mandolin one, which is...
I like that.
Well, yeah, it's a tribute to Steve Martin and The Jerk, where there's a bit in that film. It's a very good film, by the way. They're shooting at the cans! Protect the cans!
I don't get the reference, I haven't seen it, but that's okay.
That's fine. It's
just look at me directly when you said that.
Yeah, there's a song that I think he plays called, I think it's You Belong to Me, where he's trying to seduce the girl. And this is like definitely, they've said this, that was an ode to that song. But I think at first, Barrow really liked that as an idea, and Utley was dead against it. And then over time, Utley was like, oh, that was actually quite a good idea, and Barrow's gone the other way, just to be fickle. And really, we shouldn't have done that. I'm drifting in deep water. Right, it's actually really cute because the album is so dark, it needs that little palate cleanser, that little, you know, pickled ginger. It needs that little daft thing in it.
But those backing vocals as well are a bit off kilter, they're a wee bit unsettling, you know.
But that's the charm. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of consistent in that sense anyway. All right, so I mean, I think what it really comes back to is the fact that a lot of people will probably complain that this isn't Dummy, and other people, but less probably, will complain that it's not Portishead by Portishead, which are both excellent albums. But for me, it's something way, way, way more unusual and could have potentially gone really wrong for them. Mm-hmm. Could have just been seen as being morose. It could have, even a few different decisions in this album, even just maybe the order of the tracks being slightly different, it could have just got bogged down. And it's such a fine balancing act.
And yeah, I mean, for instance, if you put Machine Gun at the start.
Yeah, and you blow your load.
Yeah. And it's not the best track of the album, but it's the most sort of it stands out the most. Whereas, you know, you might be feeling quite down by, you know, track 8, and then this comes in, and you're like, oh,
absolutely,
holy shit, it sparkles.
I think like that kind of the eye for pacing in that way. It's a band that I've been about for 17 years. You can tell that. You know, you're just like, this is like a project that these people know what they're fucking doing, and they've just, yeah, I love that stubborn nonchalance. As I say, that the band exhibit, and it's all the way through this album, and just partly because of it, you're like, fuck, I love this, man. And yeah, not that I think they give a shit, because no. I think they like it, and that's all that matters.
Yeah, too.
Newsflash, yeah. Chris Cusack admires stubbornness.
I'm looking to work at it. I'm too pliable, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly, you're too.
Let's find out, let's talk about Descendants in the future and see how pliable I am.
But yeah, no, I completely agree. I just fucking really like this record.
Well, Mark, you're the newbie. What do you think?
I enjoyed it, and I would put it in the discography. I would.
That's unanimous then. And if anybody votes against it, it's just because you just don't get it.
I mean, I know we've been in a roll lately because a lot of the records we've said should go and have went in. Most recently, Nine Inch Nails, Down a Spiral, which some people voted no on, which is bizarre. And I think if this record didn't get in, I actually think that the future of this podcast would feel a little bit
hollow,
yeah, because the discography would feel worse off if this record was not in it.
Mm.
Yeah, and it kind of defines opinion. What we're trying to do.
Yeah,
maybe
we're being a wee bit stubborn though by picking this one and not the other ones. But I think Portishead would admire that stubbornness. I also think just as well, just before we cap this, if anybody hasn't heard that version of SOS that they've done,
oh yeah, it's trying to find it's on the soundtrack to High Rise,
and it's available, and the money goes to the charity that was set up for following the death of Joe Cox. And it's a really beautiful take. I mean, ABBA are amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. But it's a beautiful take on that song in a very Portishead style.
So we've decided then this is going to go in if you guys agree with us, and you better. Basically. So what are we doing next then? What's next week's episode?
What are we doing next, Mark? Can you tell from the expression on my face?
We're doing Coolie With You by Descendants.
Can I still call them the Descendants?
If you want. Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Oh, one more thing. Ding.
Go and vote on Facebook and prove us right or wrong, and give us a like and a retweet and all that kind of nonsense. But yeah, gentlemen, thank you.